folks, my name is Anupam and I'm a research fellow at the Takshashila Institution. Basically, I've been trained as an economist, I did my master's in economics, and now I'm continue to do research in economics, plus I teach for some of our flagship courses. So today, I mean, we've been talking about this for a while now, and I don't know how many of you were there at 50p, and then how many of you followed up with the 50p blog and so on. This is something that we've kind of written about previously and briefly about, you know, what's the kind of competition in the payment industry, and especially given that the government is getting itself involved so much in the payment industry. So what kind of implications does that have? And that's briefly what I want to talk about. But just before that, I just want to get a sense, anyone from a non-tech background here, I know generally HasGeek tends to draw people from the tech industry. What have you done? Just sort of out of curiosity.
Yeah, okay.
In advertising? No? Okay. Is that still
That's
okay. Okay. So, I mean, where I come from is obviously more in from an economic perspective, right? And I just want to first start off with kind of keep putting some context in the whole thing. So there have been a lot of people shouting that, you know, now the payment industry is not really competitive because, you know, NPCI basically rules over everyone else, right? And then you also have the fact that people are claiming that, you know, there's too much government interference into the in the payment industry and so on. So we have to set that in context. I mean, if we don't, we think of this as an aberration, that's something that doesn't happen usually. But to start off with, I would just like to say that banking has always been an oligopoly, right? This particular space has always suffered from concentration of market power, from excessive government interference, especially in India. I mean, and this is true for most of the world, but I think it's a bit more pronounced in India, especially because of nationalization and so on. So if you look at how do you judge how free and open a particular space is, right? So first you look at how easy it is to enter that space and how easy it is to exit. So in terms of entry, the Indian banking industry is quite terrible. I mean, you have to get an RBI license to start off with, and then getting that license is definitely not easy. You have to show that you have enough paid-up capital, that you can really meet all sorts of capital adequacy ratios, you can meet prudential requirements, etc., etc. So there's a whole list of things that you'll have to kind of prove to them that you're capable of being a bank, and even then it's a matter of lottery. Okay, so pointer towards this as to how tough it is to get into the payment industry, or rather the banking industry as a whole, is that between 2000 and 2014, this is the time when we saw rapid growth, right? Between 2000, especially after 2004, we saw at least 3 or 4 years of 9% growth, and even otherwise we were right up there, I mean 8%. Even during the financial crisis, we grew at about 7.8% and so on. So at a time when there was rapid and accelerating growth, we didn't see any new banks open up. So we were still stuck with our age-old SBI and the entrenched players, the players who were already been in the market. So I think that was something that, and as a whole, I don't think there was really a lot of changes in that banking industry in terms of even regulation, easing up regulations or making it easy for the existing players even. Forget about new players entering into the system, but what about existing players who've been there? Did it make it easy for them to open up new branches or to innovate and to make new products and so on? Right? So I don't think there was really a lot of changes on any of these fronts. And you could say, of course, that, you know, the governors at that point in time and RBI in general were battling, you know, bigger things like the 2007-8 financial crisis, and then what did the government do in as a response to that? That really sucked off a lot of the energy of RBI at that point of time. So 2014 was in that sense a landmark year in terms of a lot of things got pushed through. So 2014 saw 22 new licenses that they gave, out of which I think there was 11 payment bank licenses, so including Paytm and India Post and then Airtel Money. All of these got provisional okays from the RBI, and then it kind of played out over the years, right? And over the next 2 years.
These licenses, they're only for banks,
for all payments. So you need a payment bank license to kind of function in the payment industry. So at the minimum, I mean, of course, you need a full bank license. There's about 3 to 4 different kinds of licenses that are there. So at the top, you have a full bank license, such as you have SBI, Canara Bank, and so on. At the next is a payment bank license. license. So there you can accept deposits, but you can't really lend at big scale and so on. And then you have a small scale in the small scale banks kind of thing. So these are your typical rural banks, cooperative banks, etc. And then there are so many others, right?
The wallets. Suppose
the wallet is part of, I mean, you need a license from the RBI to operate. But to truly work in the way that Paytm has, right, in terms of interoperability, to some extent, you need a payment bank license, which is what Paytm did. And we'll get to how what Paytm did. It's actually quite interesting.
Is it in the same category as Paytm right now?
Sorry?
Ola Money, is it in the same category as Paytm?
No, it doesn't have a full payment bank license. So in Ola, for example, I mean, it's just making payments, right? Ola can't accept deposits.
Yeah, but exactly. You can use Ola Money in other services.
You can, yeah. I mean, you can use Ola Money, but it's just again making payments and probably receiving payments.
Okay.
But you can't, I mean, the whole point about banking is about accepting deposits.
Okay. Unless you ask for refunds, you can't.
Paytm can use the money deposits.
Now, yeah, once now that they've got the payment bank license, now they can really expand into other territories of, I mean, slightly going into traditional banking.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so as a general rule, you can stop me anytime at any point. These are just a few pointers that I have. So if you think all of this is too banal, I just want to give a bit of background. So if all of this sounds too trivial, you can stop me and just tell me to move on to the main point, or you can tell me to expand on that thing. So you have complete freedom. This is an open house, right? So I don't want to make it like a talk. Okay.
So I still don't understand the difference between the Ola Money as well as the Paytm. Both of them, you can transact and you can pay for something.
Yeah.
What is the thing that you can do using a payment bank more than what you can do through
payment bank? You can start accepting deposits, essentially, right? And then what you can also do, sorry?
Bank give interest.
Yeah, and then pay interest on that. And then what Paytm can do in the future is that they can use that money to also about interoperability, right? So now there are...
1% aspect to the other person.
Not just between wallets and traditional bank accounts, between wallets and let's say
Ola,
Ola, I don't think right now has that this thing yet.
Well, you can use Ola Money and other services, but that's about it.
Yeah, so you can transfer money from a traditional bank account onto your Ola Money, obviously, but you can't do it the other way around. So if using my Ola Money, I can't transfer to your bank account.
No,
I think
it's essentially like a coupon system, right? It's like a coupon system, electronic coupon system. Why you pay money to Ola, you can use their.
No, but
Paytm got a payment bank license in 2014.
But no, but they didn't start the payment bank until
Yeah, it started just now.
Yeah, so earlier also you could transfer money to other people with Paytm, right?
Other people, yeah, but other people's bank account.
No, you transfer to their Paytm, they can transfer to.
Yeah, but there is still a difference. Larger scheme of things, it does matter for RBI, for regulation and so on.
Yeah. Interoperability,
I don't think Ola still allows transfers between two
individuals. I don't know. I don't use Ola Money personally, so I wouldn't know.
But you have to be one Ola Money to transfer. You can't transfer outside.
Can you transfer between two if you have to go
back?
Legally, I mean, if it's a wallet, then you can transfer to another wallet.
Okay.
I mean, another wallet of the same company. So Ola Money can only pay to Ola Money. Ola Money can't pay to Paytm.
Yeah.
Right. So there are all these kind of restrictions on what kind of payments you can make. And that's why it's at that small scale, right? A wallet is only that much system, but a payment bank can do a lot more. And then, of course, a traditional bank has the full range of functions that it can go in. And the banking industry has always been heavily, heavily regulated. In terms of what it can do and what it cannot do, RBI puts severe restrictions on every bank. Not just restrictions, but it also dictates many of its policies. So you start off with having your entry and exit, which we spoke about, but it also controls their day-to-day operations. So for example, I mean, the RBI dictates how much money you have to keep as reserves. I mean, I'm not saying any of this is bad or good right now. I'm just saying how it's regulated, right? Because there's a lot of talk about how payment industry should be completely freed up and so on. Again, you just have to think that it's coming from the banking sector, so it can't or won't be radically different. Again, I'm not making any value judgments at this point, I'm just saying how things are. So, RBI controls their day-to-day operations, so it tells them how much reserves they have to keep, these are called prudential norms and so on, and then what kind of, who do you lend to? RBI has a big say in who the banks lend to, right? They don't have complete freedom, so for example, it's the priority sector lending fees. they have some things on priority sector lending. So every bank is forced to lend a certain percentage of their deposits to farmers, to rural households, to something else. Every bank is forced to set up an X number of branches in rural areas. Branches are also told to do a lot of other things, right? I mean, which according to RBI, it's meeting its basically social development goals. So if you look at the mandate of RBI as a central bank, what it was supposed to do, right, only now has it changed to a pure, you know, inflation targeting and basically price stability as its core function. But if you go back just even a couple of years back before it was changed, before the Monetary Policy Committee was formed and so on, the mandate of RBI was extremely large. It said growth, it said employment generation, it said so many other things, right? About making financial inclusion and so on. All of that has been removed now, right? Just inflation targeting. But it meant that up till that point, RBI used commercial banks to achieve all of these objectives, right? So we have to understand that, you know, it's how it was spent. The biggest change was that RBI also controlled what the savings bank rate was. So your not your fixed deposits and so on, banks had this thing, but your savings bank would only rate your normal transacting account, bank account. The interest rate that our commercial banks would give to you was always within a band which was specified by the RBI. Okay, so I mean that again regulating that was a big thing. Now they have deregulated. So okay, and this is the biggest thing. Commercial banks have always suffered from heavy government intervention, right? This is apart from RBI. RBI is a central bank, but from the fiscal side as well, it has always suffered from heavy government intervention into things that probably me and you would think that the government has absolutely no business in, right? So look at, the biggest thing, of course, was the bank nationalization. It was done in two rounds, one in 1969. Again, am I boring you with all the history and so on? One was the bank nationalization in 1969, where 14 major banks were nationalized, right? And then again, about six or so in 1980. So about 21 banks were nationalized and then two were merged, which meant that essentially what it meant was that the central government, or government entities controlled up to 91% of the banking sector, right, in 1980s. So and then obviously there's been a wave of liberalization, one in 90s. None of the public sector banks have been privatized, but it only meant that more private sector banks have been allowed to come in, and foreign banks have also been allowed to come in, which meant that their overall share of the banking sector has reduced. But it still holds a significant percentage of this thing, right? And then, of course, so this is something I don't know if I want to get into this much detail, but you said something called the SLR, which is a statutory liquidity ratio that basically means that all commercial banks have to keep a certain percentage of their deposits as government securities or government approved securities, right? So one thing is called the CRR, which is the cash reserve ratio. So they keep a certain percentage of their deposits as cash with RBI. So this is meant for liquidity purpose. So basically we understand how banks work, right? If all of us deposit there and it works on, let's say half of this room deposits there, it works on the principle that not everyone in this room would withdraw money at the same time, which means it keeps just a part of it as reserves, and the rest of it lends to, let's say, this half of the room, right? That's how traditional banking works. So the required prudential, that those are what you call as risk capital or prudential, this thing, right? So what the ideal number that is, it varies across different countries, but the risk capital should not be more than 7%. Whereas in India, it is 20 plus, I mean, it was as high as 30, but let's say currently it is 20.5 as SLR and 6% or 4% as CRR. Right, so that's 25% that banks have to keep aside and they cannot lend to private players.
What is the SLR and CRR?
These are prudential norms. So basically the amount of, the percentage of the
Sanford
CRR is cash reserve ratio. So that's how much cash they have to keep with RBI. And SLR is statutory liquidity ratio. So this is the...
So SLR is what you keep with yourself and CRR is what you keep with RBI?
No, SLR, yeah, you keep it with yourself, but only in government approved securities. So basically what that translates to is that the government is arm twisting banks to lend it to the government itself.
That, SLR norms do not seem like a form of arm twisting, since the government is the indirectly the maintainer of the currency. So I don't see how
currency.
It is basically, it is the maker of the currency, right? Currency is coming out of thin air. So, if they are making SLR norms to limit the liquidity in the market, I don't really see that as a form of arm twisting into lending for government. Indirectly, if the government was short on cash, they would just print more currency.
No, but that leads to inflation.
Exactly. So instead of doing that, they're doing it by SLR.
But they're doing it via mine and your savings, and what that means
but
is that.
But it's for public funded causes. It's not like they're printing the money.
So basically,
yeah, no, regardless of that, so what a government is supposed to do, if you want to get into this, is it's supposed to raise revenue and then spend it, not basically rob people's savings and then use it for, even if it is development.
You may agree with it, I may not agree with it. See, government bond is a sign of trust that the government is valuable, right? That should be a supply and demand thing. If I trust it, I buy it. You can't force the banks to say, okay, you take a bond.
If you go down that route, then the currency itself is also a trust in the
government. Yeah, it's a trust.
If you go down the route, then the government is arm twisting by making SLR norms. See, this is just a pedantic part. I don't want to belabor it.
No, but
I think saying that they are arm twisting by
SLR norms,
if they don't have SLR norms, they still have to meet their political slash spending objectives.
Precisely. I'm glad you bought it, right? You bought it about
which
means that if you don't arm twist banks, and I'm sorry, I am using this word, if you don't really arm twist banks, then that means that the government is forced into, firstly, fiscal responsibility, so it will not spend as much as it does, and secondly, it is also forced into raising its revenues, which means widen its tax base. It won't do stupid things like farm loan waivers. It will not do. It will not give away money for free. It will not give free washing machines and sewing machines and whatnot, right?
I guess what I'm saying is,
so,
you say they are interested to meet their budget deficit. If they don't use that tool, then they'll either not.
No,
then they'll either be
they
responsible,
to,
but they should be doing.
No, that means they have to borrow from the government. They have to borrow from markets.
See,
the only other way is to borrow from markets.
Yeah, but the market is not able to meet their needs. Either they become responsible, which is the right thing to do.
Yeah.
Or instead of arm twisting, they'll do the other bad thing, which is inflating.
You can't really, government, central bank, I mean, the central government does not have complete powers to print money. Right? Because that is a function of the RBI.
Yeah, then actually arm twisting is also through the RBI, since the RBI is the one that auctions the bonds.
Sure, but this is much more. This is much more direct. Printing money is a much more direct way, and which will raise.
The auctioning of bonds, the government treasury bonds, is all done through RBI. RBI is the one that only.
Yeah, of course it is, but this is still considered as a market transaction where government, I mean, banks still are purchasing it, right? Even though they're arm twisted. But printing money is something that no one will think. So, for example, if your credit rating agencies, if they know that the government is printing money in that sense to meet its budgetary deficits, you will have a downgrade immediately, but this doesn't lead to a downgrade. So you need to do it in a slightly indirect fashion, just to hide it. Is this a really better practice than that? Absolutely not, but it just hides the fact. Well, that's what.
No, I think even the argument that government can print any print money is not necessarily stand, because to the extent that they can, they already do.
Yeah,
even beyond that, whatever they need is something that they source from various locations.
Deficit financing,
and it's not
is always
entirely in their hands, not
so
to print
before
whichever the money that they want.
Okay.
To whatever the extent they can, they already do. Even beyond that, they need other locations.
See, before 1994,
inflation for one?
Yeah, but that inflation, anywhere you introduce,
I mean,
people,
there are many other
inflation. Things.
What? I don't know. But I'm
the
sure
only point I'm trying to make is SLR is also by the government, and printing currency is also by the government. We have chosen SLR as a rule, which is better than printing currency. To meet deficits.
Okay, so I mean,
not having
this
deficits
is
obviously a much better
this is just saying,
sort of thing.
Okay, fine, I get your point, but this is just saying that, you know, hacking two of your limbs is better than killing you. But neither is really
that's
an option
that
you
remotely close to that.
No, it is.
That analogy is okay.
According to me, it is
not
exactly
having
anyways
budgetary deficit is obviously a good goal.
I think.
But if you are going to have that, then how do you meet it? Either through SLR or through.
So what you're failing to understand is, if you take away this very easy source and understand that printing money is not easy, okay, it is not easy, and governments cannot just print money. Let me just come.
Yeah, I agree with that. That part is
okay. Which means that if you remove this SLR practice, then the government will be forced to adhere to market discipline. It will be forced, and that's what happens the world over, right? I don't see why India should be an exception. Anywhere in the world, because you don't have SLR, the maximum percent that you would ever see is about 7%. And this is according to Basel III norms, which is actually called LCR. So they have to keep about 6.5% in trusted securities. And even that, they have an option of buying any securities in the world. So for example, I don't know if I'm going too deep into this, but Indian banks are forced to buy only government approved securities, which means government securities. But under the Basel III norms, let's say Canara Bank can buy securities of New Zealand government treasury bills, right? Because it's ultra safe. And in that sense, New Zealand's bond is rated AAA, whereas India's bond is rated BBB. So why you? It is arm twisting in that sense. So anyway, let's carry this on. If you have, I don't want to. Yeah.
So how strongly do other countries comments control the banks?
I mean, they. The regulation that different countries do, I mean, it is. I cannot give a strong, I mean, blanket answer at all. But let's say the Federal Reserve, the licenses are given much more easier, obviously. And most of the countries now, let's say the European countries and so on, all of them adhere to something called the Basel III norms, which is a part of self-regulation and so on. In fact, I mean, if you want to get a very crisp, quick answer, the whole 2007-8 crisis was a result of absolute lack of regulation, that it was left far too free, right? Because some of the prudential norms that the banks are supposed to follow were completely left. So then they came up with the Basel III norms, and you know that the Basel is Switzerland where they actually came up with these set of norms as to how much percentage you keep as safety net and so on. And that was done much later on just to avoid something like the 2007-8 financial crisis. So if you look at it that way, I mean, some of these, what we think as rat-case regulations did help us. Okay, but I think it is just too much. I mean, it's a matter of numbers again. 20.5 as SLR is far too high, whereas something like 6-7% is more than enough as a risk capital. Whereas in the US at that point of time, it was less than 2%, which is what led to the crisis. And then, of course, I don't want to get into the 7-8 crisis. Okay. So that is one problem. And then you have schemes such as, you know, your Uday and so on, which is the discom, state discoms, which are had taken massive loans and they need loans to basically even operate on a day-to-day basis because they cannot raise money. I mean, the kind of pricing that electricity, I mean, the kind of electricity pricing that is existing in India right now is abysmal, right? India pays the cheapest, pays the least for electricity anywhere in the world, that's a statistic. And that is, that only means that DISCOMs and other power generation capacities don't have any money. And they're in bad loans, and that loans are written off periodically from the banks. So again, that's government basically stealing money from banks. Okay, and then finally you have the farm loan waiver, which was just again.
Are these loans taken from private banks also, like your HDFC and all?
No, mostly from nationalized banks. But it does not mean that. So okay, here's how it works. The DISCOMs still have to go to the banks for a loan. And more often than not, the private banks just do not give them. And the nationalized banks do not want to give them either, but then the government steps in and says, I'm sorry, you have to.
Is there a solution for it?
Yeah.
Again,
couple of things. One, yeah, you have to stop subsidizing electricity to this extent. You have to raise electricity prices so that this comes are not in absolute bankrupt state, right? And then from there you take it on. Anyway, that's quite a big issue. But water, but that's the same problem with all of our public services, water, electricity. None of this is railways. None of this is ever charged at the price that it's supposed to be charged, which means government subsidizes. And if government subsidizes it, where does that money come from? Ultimately, the taxpayers, one way or the other, either they do it through direct tax collection or indirect tax collection, or basically by stealing our deposits in one way or the other, such that we don't get the required interest rates that markets would have otherwise given because of its big NPAs and all of that, and we don't have access to credit. Oh, okay, this is probably
Uber also does the same thing, basically using money. We subsidize our taxi fare using VC money.
Okay, so yeah, and then the final kind of things that banks have control over, I mean, sorry, government has control over banks is by the appointment of MDs and how basically banks have, I mean, government has control over who is appointed as the MD of each bank and so on, such that if you get a player, if you get right at the top, if you get your people in, then that means there would be a lot more sympathetic to the government's cause. So that means that you can then tell these commercial banks to give you money when you want it, right? So that's the full circle of how this thing works. So coming to payments more specifically, okay. I'll just carry on while they do that, right? So, as I said, 2014 was where things started changing a lot. There had been some kind of movements from 2008 onwards, but for example, the NPCI was set up in 2008, but it really got a big boost in its kind of activities only after 2014, where a lot of things were started. Seeing RuPay, for example, was in 2012. But it started kicking off only much later, right? So 2014 was really, according to me, this thing, and especially because you had a governor who understood the importance of the fintech space and understood, you know, the digital payment angle and so on. So, and he was extremely sympathetic towards that cause. And so it made a lot of changes. One, I said the biggest change was granting all those new licenses. But apart from that, they made a lot of the RBI policies which came out was in favor of digital payment and the fintech space. So, I mean, just to give you some random figures, I think in 2013 alone, there were 2015, there was about 750 new fintech companies that were established, and that's the largest that India has ever seen. And these were, out of which a lot of them were in the payment space and so on. But that also just shows that RBI opened it up for new companies to come in, so small startups to start doing payments or just making the banking sector easier. So they would take up like one small role of the big banks, and then you know, kind of just ease that and infuse technology to make it.
You said
750,
right?
Sorry?
You said numbers.
I think so. I've written about it somewhere, but I don't exactly remember.
But I'm guessing most of them are folded because. Don't
really absolutely. A lot of the startups, I mean, they start, they close, but it just meant that
one of these are wallets, like DTH providers are wallets. Everyone has a wallet, so they're not really people who are going to come and tell you, like, open an account with us, but they're probably selling something else and getting the
wallet. Yeah, but it just meant that at least entrance to the space was now slightly opening up. That's about it. A lot of them die. I mean, startups open and, I mean, you know, start and die.
Majority of them die.
Sorry?
Majority of startups, right?
Yeah, so yeah. The success rate and the actual longevity of startups is quite low. But it just means that this space was now opened up for new entrants into the system. So the NPCI, and it's kind of important to understand where NPCI is and what it does. So the NPCI was, again, it was started in 2008. It is basically a not-for-profit, that's what they say, private organization. No, it is not for profit. I don't think they make a profit or anything. And which is owned by a consortium of banks. And this is the important thing. It's not just because it's regulated by the RBI and it got approval by the RBI does not mean it's a government organization. I think a lot of people make that mistake. I will not presume that any of you do, but I just want to make it clear nonetheless. NPCI is a private organization. Okay, under any kind of thinking that it is not a government organization. It's not national in the sense of, you know, that it's a government. But they, so what they do is basically it's an umbrella organization for. Yeah.
How did they get the name
exactly?
There's been a lot of debate on that. if you can't have republic, then can you have national?
You can't use the word.
You can't use the national. Yeah, it's been flouted a lot of times. But according to the listing, constituting the words republic. I'm saying it was because of Arnab National. These are things that you cannot use very, I don't know, very easily. You must have government approval to use it. All.
They were forced to change from Indian to international because of the government. See, if you're not
Nobody approves international.
But you can get India or Indian name if you value that exports or something.
Yeah, but what if it was forced to change it? Because they are
non-profit.
Indian Oil is anyway, I mean, it's partly a government, I mean, not partly, mostly a government owned.
What about companies like India Hikes, India this, India that?
I think India you can, Indian.
India only requires a certain market cap. Your paid up capital has to be X amount.
See, as far as I know, and please do not quote me on this, the word national, there is a kind of restriction on using that word by in the constitution itself, or one of the, if I'm not mistaken. So it says you can't use this, it's partly this thing. But again, I'm not really sure, I'll get back to
that. So one thing is that nobody is clear whether national something is legal or not. National is illegal.
The
Republic TV is.
That's it. You just have to read the ad. I'm not sure at any point, if I'm not wrong, NPCI can convert itself from a Section 25 company to a fully private limited.
Yes, it can.
Right?
So it's fully private, right?
It can become a public, it can be listed in public, I guess so. I think that would be a long term plan, considering if they want to make payments and industry, they would make this a
could be. I mean, that's a possibility which is definitely open, right? Which would then really defy all of the competition things that which you're going to talk about.
No,
so
there is monopoly in a way that controls all other banks and not talk to each other through IMPS. And if they were a for profit, because they are a monopoly, they could jack up the prices to 2% of all transaction charges in order to make good for their for profit.
Yeah,
but, so that's why they are non profit, so that they are in a position in order to actually.
What if it becomes, you can convert yourself into a for profit organization from Section 25 into a whatever full fledged company, and then what? NPCI's shareholding requirement to be part of NPCI is that you have to be part of the Indian Banking Association, and even there not everyone gets to be part of the NPCI. Okay, so that's this thing. So what NPCI does, I think most of you know, it does various kind of payment systems. Basically, one of its biggest things before was IMPS, but the only difference between IMPS and what now you see as UPI and so on is that IMPS didn't have the facility to request payment, which UPI does. Okay, so UPI is nothing but it's a platform which is built on NPCI, right? on top of IMPS, right? So IMPS is immediate payment systems. And that kind of, before you had NEFT and so on, where the clearing would take an hour or 2 or 4 hours previously. Now, IMPS was something which was immediate. The minute you sent money, it would happen. UPI is just built on the IMPS platform. And NPCI owns all of this. Developed all of this.
What is Aadhaar Payment Bridge?
Aadhaar Payment Bridge is, I mean, this was something which was in between what you now have as Aadhaar Pay and Aadhaar Enabled Payment. So I don't know what exactly it did. Honestly, I really don't.
It was primarily for direct payment transfers.
It was meant for that, which is now kind of absolutely. Aadhaar payment, I mean the bridge. This thing was for DBT, for the government to track for money to this thing. Now it's taken over by your other payment system. So they now want to use UPI itself across the board, and then you have the other pay, which what is that? You can use
APA
is other enabled payment system where you can use with just a standard but without the smartphone itself, right?
Beam
actually incorporated and swallowed the other pay that they had initially thought of. So that is what using your SSID this thing.
So you need to look at BIM as an app and APS as a protocol.
BIM is just an app.
Just an app and a protocol. So anybody can build a BIM. And now what's happening is, from what I was told today, they're gonna deprecate or rather merge APS and UPI.
Yeah.
To use UPI, you're going to be as biometric art soon, once your phones are going to start supporting
biometric
scans.
Right.
Well, I checked on the term national.
Yeah.
The Symbols Act basically says, in the list of permitted groups, any name which may suggest or be calculated to suggest, one, the patronage of the government of India or the government of a state, or two, connection with any local authority or any corporation or body constituted by the government under any law for the time being enforced. So it does not mention the words national democratic anything. It basically says if it sounds like the government is
anywhere.
It
is subjective, right?
But to the person.
But there is one more national republic, I remember that.
There's also a national
then,
productivity
so,
council.
Sorry,
there's
national
also
productivity
a national
council.
Productivity council of India, NPCA.
Yeah.
the list of things prohibited from
government name
include the word Auroville, include St. John's,
St. John's Hospital,
include Ramakrishna Math, include
Indira
Gandhi, all of them are explicitly named.
No, the
time
is
Yeah, they're not interested.
Yeah, because Auroville, the government intervened when the thing happened.
The government gives them an act of parliament.
No, they had to take over the thing. So
but I think, just the curious thing with NPCI is that the government has enforced it, endorsed it throughout. So even if people think, you know, that it is sounds like a government thing, they're absolutely fine with it. I mean, the government of India has no problem with it. In fact, the government of India wants people to think of NPCI as a government organization. And I'll show you how they've done it. I mean, I have a interesting thing. Okay, so this is just the NPCI shareholding pattern. I've not put the source, but this is from MediaNama.
This one is from
the
what are the media report? But I took it from MediaNama. So just the important thing to see here is that the top 10 or 11 banks right up front own about 75% of the shares.
Okay, so is HSBC, despite being foreign banks, are in the top
So the rest of it, I mean, it gets really diluted towards here, the share of
how is this classification made? Like, on what basis is the share decided?
I don't know. I really don't know. It's a good idea. Market cap or something, but it's not accountable for that. They've never mentioned that. In fact, I mean, the Water Committee report specifically said that the NPCA, now that it's taking on what you call is critical infrastructure, right? That is national payments. That it has to spread the shareholding across the banks more evenly, and it should not be left in the top 10. But the top 10, whatever the first bracket is, the same people who also own the majority this thing in the IBA, that is the Indian Bankers Association. So you see that very nice little nexus there. Now I'm making it sound like a conspiracy. some of the problems with this is so NPCI, UPI, and market power, right? So some of the problems with NPCI as this thing is that initially when the talks were about NPCI, when even the governor on so on said that it was going to be the UPI was going to be a completely open and decentralized platform. So it was just that they were going to build the platform and then open it up for everyone. That it was going to be nearly open source. Okay, this is what they initially said. And then the typical, I don't remember where I read it, but someone said that if two college students can build an app, and they'd be free to use the UPI platform to build an app for payments.
So
but
they
right now
did that while they were promoting it at the sandbox.
Yeah.
Before they made it commercial live, they had a test set of APIs which they gave access to everybody in the world,
yeah,
including private companies like WhatsApp, Facebook, all of them. Now they are kind of restricting it once it went live.
Yeah, once it went live, now you basically you have to be one of the big partner banks there, or if it's a private company you want to build something on UPI, you have to partner and collaborate with one of those banks. So for example, your phone pay is a Flipkart product, but they have to partner with Yes Bank because they have the API. So the API is not given out to anybody now. If I request for an API to build a UPI app, I will definitely not be given unless I partner with someone.
So when you say UPI app, what does it actually mean? Since I'm not a bank, but I want to build a UPI app, so what will it have?
So basically, all that UPI app does, it uses the platform to just connect two bank accounts. That's about it. So I can build an app which, if you give me permission, then I take money from his bank account and then give password. That's about it.
So my question is, there was an issue with ICICI not allowing to pay transactions, right? I guess even Citibank is doing it, right?
Yeah.
So how come that happened despite the two banks being in the top, top of the structure?
There is a structure for NPCI, not UPI.
But UPI comes under NPCI.
Yeah,
right?
But UPI doesn't fit.
There's also some degree of competition between them. You don't want, I mean, that was the same thing with, ICICI and Flipkart, right? That they didn't want PhonePay to become part two.
Yeah.
PhonePay was the most popular.
I use PhonePay, whereas Citibank earlier used to support the transaction, now it doesn't.
Yeah. So, I mean, that's what NPCI doesn't like, and that's where they're getting really angry about these things. But then you want to try and limit people. So you're trying to tell them that, use our app instead. That's about it. So there's some bit of infighting, and for me, that I'm very happy about. I mean, some customers might be inconvenienced in the near future, but then in the long run, I want there to be competition between different players such that, I mean, ideally, I would like to see five banks tear away from this and build their own platform. Not that they're allowed.
From technical and banking terms, if a bank doesn't accept payment, say I'm paying you, I give you a check, but your bank rejects it, it's not my problem.
Yeah.
My bank is trying to give you money,
yeah,
but
yeah,
your
yeah.
bank rejects it, it's their penalties.
So I know that's what Citi does. Citi rejects
uh-huh.
it.
So
yeah.
there are penalties, which are not there in UPI current specification, which they're going to change. I guess.
So that's what let me say, that not everyone has access to the UPI, okay? I mean, to the APIs. Next comes to the specific app. So Beam is just an app, and it is an app obviously built on the UPI platform, and this is built by NPCI itself, okay? So this is not built by a private party or a bank, but it's built by NPCI itself. So now obviously you can imagine that there's going to be huge problems with anyone who's a platform as well as a player in the market, right? It leads to just a distortion in the market. And you can think of the kind of riots or whatever, the strikes, not riots, strikes that we had when Uber and Ola launched its own cars. And it's the same principle there, right? That if Uber is a platform, Uber always claims that it's a platform and not a taxi service. It's a cab aggregator service, which meant that once they launched their own cars, which are Uber cars, it was going to be distorting. So everyone is going to claim that Uber will obviously prefer their own Uber cars rather than your third-party driver or what they call as partners, right? So it's the same problem with the NPCI. Now NPCI can say that because Beam app is their own, then can they favor the Beam app over others? Can NPCI do it? Now government is doing it, and I'll come to that slightly later on. And this is the same problem with other things which are built by the NPCI, which is this Bharat QR, other enabled payment systems, other pay, and so on. They're all built by the platform itself. So that leads to some kind of distortions. I mean, in the simplest sense, if NPCI is at some point of time forced to choose between Beam and, let's say, PhonePay, which would it choose?
All these banks are building out their own.
Very important. I'll come to that in just a second. I'll just come to that.
This one sector now with Beam, it's not linked to a bank. So how is that allowed? Why is there encryption only for NPCI and not for other private?
That's precisely my point. That is precisely my point.
And
that
nobody has.
No, people have raised it. I mean, I myself have raised it. But the fact is that
are they legal?
It's legal. Because
are they legal ways to question it? No.
No, because
NPCI is private, they can do whatever they want.
Yeah. And see, that was the point of NPCI being there in the first place. I mean, the UPI platform was exactly that
yeah.
anyone could build,
yeah.
who are not banks, can build an app
yeah.
which will make payments easy, right? So the problem is not that Beam is there, but the problem is that others are not,
okay, yeah.
that
exactly.
they're not allowing others. So that's the problem. I mean, personally, if NPCI has an app called Beam, I have no problem with
yeah.
it. I mean, I have a problem in the sense that they are, you know, the platform and the,
yeah.
The player, but otherwise it's okay, right? But the problem is that others cannot do it. Everyone else has to partner with the bank, but Beam doesn't. This thing. Finally, what about the government? So, you know, I'm trying to take it in the same thing that we spoke about banking industry, right? So there's regulation, there's problems, anti-competitive, and etc. And finally, you know, the government interference into the payment systems. So this is for me. First problem for me is that the government preferred UPI as the preferred, you know, as in its big push towards digital payment, and we know how the government went about doing it. In its big push towards digital payment, it specifically chose UPI to be its whatever messiah and its tool of delivering Nirvana, right? So it said that UPI and especially other things built by NPCI is going to be your main tool. So they promoted it exclusively. Now, I have a fundamental problem with the government promoting and endorsing a product which is built by a private organization. It is unfair. Now, is this the only place where it happens? No. But again, this is a big enough kind of deviation from your standard market competition and tools. So I personally have a very big problem with this. So, for example, I mean, look at the Beam app when it was launched. It was firstly launched by the Prime Minister himself. Why is the Prime Minister launching a private product? I mean, do you see that common anywhere else? You don't, really. They go and launch bridges and ports which people have built, but not really a private product. So that's a problem. And you, this is, again, one of his, this thing, you know, where he's openly promoting. This is, you know, a tweet from him. And there was this, this is of course not from the most reliable source, but it tells you this from Swarajya Mag. I will not comment anything about the publication, but it says Prime Minister's Beam app makes world record with 17 million downloads. I don't know what kind of world record that is. No one cared to explain to me. Because I seriously don't know what kind of world record that is. Because in terms of...
The Prime Minister app.
Yeah, that's the world record. That's the world record. And the Prime Minister has an app.
Not the Prime Minister, probably has 17 million
downloads. No, actually, Prime Minister's Beam.
Yeah.
Because it's its own previous record of 16.9 million.
I'm not sure of the laws around here, but government employees, executive, are actually complying by certain acts where you're not supposed to be favoring any So technically, we can sue the Prime Minister.
I honestly don't know about the legality of it, but in terms of, I know the Civil Service Code specifies this, okay, definitely. In terms of ministers, I don't know. Honestly, I've not done the legal groundwork, but I'm sure the government, whether it's legally possible or not, I think it is just extremely problematic if the government starts endorsing a private product. I mean, can you think of the Prime Minister posing with a bottle of Coca-Cola and saying, I prefer this to Pepsi? We can't imagine that, and we would think of that as outrageous. But why are we okay with this? Paytm did that, but I don't think, I don't know what kind of consent was taken and so on, but yeah.
They have 500 rupees fine.
Yeah, 5,000. I'm sure Vijay Shekhar can't afford that.
The note was banned. So
yeah.
He paid through Paytm.
So,
you can answer that yourself when
yeah.
you start pushing Aadhaar for payment soon. So
see, I really don't want to get into that aspect of it, but
there's this thing, India Stack, and then you have this, and you know, making Aadhaar compulsory, and then this payment.
India Stack is also a private effort.
India Stack is a private effort, which is also part of India Stack builds the APIs for MPCI. I mean, it's a really twisted web, okay? But I would kind of urge you to read up on this.
So basically, there was this thing called tag up or whatever, which is tag up, right? In Nandan Company, they did a thing which told the government how to run these organizations.
Right.
So it was his idea that all these companies should be set up in such a way that government ownership is minimum, so there is no oversight from the government. So typically, if the government has set up this under RBI, there would have been a lot of oversight, the CAG audits, all of that is overcome by the fact that the government doesn't. So GSTN is similarly set up. The government only owns 49.9%
of the kind of beautiful space that these guys operate.
So there are like five different projects which are being built this way. The other ones are not so much in the public eye, but they must also be doing similar scams.
I would say scams, but I'm just being politically
correct. No, it is wrong. Because India Stack, basically, the guy who's in charge of India Stack is an ex Aadhaar, ex advisor to this, advisor to that, volunteer at this.
I'm sorry, it is
and also at Nandan Nilekani's private thing, something ex step or whatever.
India Conflict of Interest.
So,
you know, it's a big incestuous.
Yeah.
Family, right? I mean,
that's all it is.
UIDAI, right? So they have these guidelines. They recruited all of these people as volunteers, but they had agreements, contracts with that, under which they had certain codes of conduct. So you can find all of these documents online where, if they are recruiting a volunteer, how they are going to do it, what sort of rules and regulation this volunteer follows. But when I fight for an RTA to get these contracts that UIDA has with its employees, they kind of directed it to the legal team to find out the person's right whether to disclose it or not yet, as of now, okay? So, but they do have all of these in place. Legally speaking, they're covered.
Yeah.
They have the potential to do that.
See, a lot of it is, of course, there have been things that have already gone wrong. But a lot of the fear is about what can go wrong in the future, and it is not absurd paranoia, but I think there is a tinge of realism about it. Okay, so finally, I'll just cover what happened in the budget, 2017 budget. So again, there was an entire section of his Jaitley speech and later the budget document purely devoted to the app. And so it said that, you know, it basically proposed two schemes for the promotion of BEAM, which is a referral bonus scheme and a cashback scheme for merchants.
So India Stack first of all is the second volunteers, which they develop APIs that any startup can use, any other startup can use. And second, the way I see UPI is a collection of banks coming together and then running an application, which is called UPI. And when you say that it's unfair to the other payment systems, which payment system?
Everybody
has an account, and if I have this platform where I can transact money for you, because everybody has an account, everybody has Airtel money account, then Airtel money will become popular.
No, okay, so the problem is that what you're essentially doing here is restricting the kind and number of other payment systems that can come.
No, that's okay. I'm just realizing the fact that every person in India has a bank account.
Firstly, that is hardly
true. That's not true. Most of them don't have, at least
only about 40% of Indians have an active account.
More than Airtel Money, right?
That's like saying that, okay, we have enough telecom operator, why get Jio in the market?
So it's not about that, it's about if you're offering a better service, you know, obviously become the more popular.
Are you allowing for newer services to come?
How will you allow?
That is the point. I mean, I have no problem if NPCI is the most, if UPI is the favored one because it's good service and so on. But as long as it's allowing all other kinds of
competition to come.
You're not stopping also.
Yeah. Okay, by the way, I'll just give you a little bit of this thing on this. So NPCI has built a platform for UPI. Now, no one else can build another platform such as UPI. Even remotely close as UPI.
UPI is built on India Stack.
No, it's an exclusive array. Okay, so.
India Stack doesn't build anything.
India Stack is it builds APIs.
India Stack is, my term for them is paid mercenaries. They're not volunteers.
So, if
a government department wants something built, okay, a government department, as in like a government, okay, pseudo government thing like UIDA or NPCI wants something built, India Stack people will go build it for them. Okay, it is not like a Linux kernel that they're building as
volunteers. It's not an open source thing that anyone can use. Okay, these are specifically and exclusively built for their partners. So, all I'm saying, and from the RBI and regulation side, if let's say I have the technology and this thing to build another big payment platform to rival UPI, I cannot do that. By law, I'm not allowed to do it. Now that is why it is anti-popular.
A related question. If somebody reverse engineers and publishes it, what are the penalties?
It doesn't matter if it's public. Now let's say everyone comes to know about it, but by law you're not allowed to, because it's got critical infrastructure, you need permission from the RBI, and RBI will not give you permission to develop another payment system.
No, the protocol is open. The API is open.
You know exactly what's happening, but you cannot use it.
The definition of openness is questionable.
Yeah.
It's a Microsoft kind of openness. You need the source code and you cannot.
In essence, yes. So, I mean,
Windows shopping.
Honestly, the other thing is that, see, honestly, I'm just kind of telling you that the whole thing about NPCI and so on is quite shrouded in mystery, right? I've tried to look at the Indian Bankers Association's their charter and so on. Can any other bank join? Can other non-banking institutions join the NPCI and so on? It's frankly quite shrouded, and it requires a lot of, it requires a legal mind to look at it. Honestly, I'm an economist. But as far as I've understood that, you can't just build another, any sort of platform like this, and neither can you even join NPCI now and say, okay, fine, can you open a gate to me? It's not that easy. Right? Which means that all of this is anti-competitive. So yeah, the budget explicitly used taxpayers' money to promote Beam. So that's the next level, right? It said, whatever these little schemes, it might not amount to much, but in principle at least, if you're saying I'm going to give you money to use a particular private product, that again, the entire thing smells wrong, right? So as I think Ken from the, Rohan from Ken says, basically you're going to use taxpayers will pay other taxpayers to route transactions through an app owned by an organization that works exclusively for banks. It just kind of sums up this particular aspect of what I'm trying to say. Finally on the budget, yes sir?
So if the government built a system like this and it was made exclusive, you didn't have a problem?
If it was made exclusive, I would definitely have a problem.
But the government
already has so many exclusive things, right?
And I have a problem with all of that.
Yeah,
government has electricity distribution, for example, is a monopoly for government in most parts of India.
Yeah.
Right? Except I think Mumbai, which has two or three electricity companies and good government. The rest of it is purely government owned. Karnataka is government owned.
Yeah.
I have a problem with that. Indian Railways is government owned and it's exclusive. I can't open up a railway track and use my own. I have a problem. So yes, but here because it was so new, right? Most of these things is a legacy of I don't know what, but because the payment industry was new, I had some hope that it could be open, and they promised openness. So finally, in the budget, they also said that Beam would be made compulsory and mandated across all kinds of government services, which again, obviously, I have a problem with. So it's basically you're handing over virtual monopoly status to NPCI, and that's where my main concern. So, okay, I'm done with this setting. Okay, so what's the problem with this? Sorry. We've discussed this in parts everywhere else, but essentially now with, I think we talked about the, what's the problem with Beam offers this, right? So now, government is subsidizing UPI transactions. Okay, because remember that all transactions basically have a transaction cost. So if you're using a debit card, debit or credit cards have transaction costs from 2-4%. Depends, Amex has a lot more, whereas something else is 2% and so on. Paytm, if you're going to
shift money from your Paytm wallet back to your bank account, that's a transaction cost. Which means that there is a transaction cost for all other transactions as well. You have to think about it because there's a limit on how much money you can keep in your Paytm wallet. Then, I mean, except cash, every other forms of payment systems have a transaction fee to it or transaction cost to it, right? Even within the Aadhaar Pay, for example, that if you use the other thing, SSID, then that also has a transaction cost to it. Now, government is essentially right now, because of its Digital India push or whatever, it's subsidizing these things through the NPCI. Now, my problem is, I don't know for how long. They initially said that UPI would have a transaction cost, fee from April or May onwards. We have to wait and watch. I'm not really up to date on this. But they said that it will have a transaction cost. Now, my big problem with this is now, if the government is subsidizing it, and they're subsidizing it from our taxpayers' money, and they're subsidizing a private product, yes, we're getting the benefit now, but that also means that you're not allowing other industries to come up because you're killing the competition there. I mean, can you imagine a new wallet player now? E-wallet? Because UPI is there, I don't think wallets will come up. Because it's a dead end thing that you're trying to get.
Why would you want a wallet? Because the present problem is, if you are using Paytm, you can't transfer money from Paytm to any other wallet.
Sure, but let people decide. I mean, I'm just saying, if someone wanted to open a new wallet, this thing, you have to kill that space.
One of the wallets which I want is a wallet through which I can pay my transit costs, like bus, train, everything. There's none. And it's a monopoly there. They have a standard for payments in transport, which nobody is implementing because there's no push, unlike demonetization with these things.
The mobility card also.
Yeah, nobody implemented it. It's there. Nobody uses it. They use Paytm. They use wallets. But as a standard, it exists.
No, yes, it uses Paytm.
Yeah. So does Delhi Metro, if I'm not mistaken. If the platform is open, if the space is open, people might have demands, and to meet that demand, other things will come up, and then competition will ensure that the costs are lowest. I mean, this is Econ 101, right? But you've effectively killed that competition space. So even within my ideal scenario is, why should you have just NPCI and the UPI? If someone can probably come up with a better system, I don't know, but it is in the realm of possibility. Someone can come up with a better system with cheaper transaction costs that need not be subsidized by the government. But you've essentially killed that because of the way the entire thing is set up.
So also, it's not even a government organization. It's the organization that is built by the bank.
It's not the government.
Like it's subsidized by the government. When the government is right now, obviously the control is wielded by the prime minister.
It's a partial government.
You feel the government is controlling this? No.
Banks
are allowing themselves to be controlled right now. They can always say, okay, we can't do this.
So there is actually a tough war happening between.
And we will charge 2% from tomorrow. They can say that.
They can. That's the biggest thing right now.
They can't
what?
Really.
See, this is why.
At the government will have to nationalize it.
Out of the 10 banks, they will nationalize
it.
State
banks. They're doing it by state limits. Out
of the 10, 8 are state-owned banks, and then there is Citibank and there's HSBC Bank. Yeah.
Sure, but even the state-owned banks, okay. Because an entity is state-owned in that sense doesn't mean that they're not profit motive. It does not mean that they're here to give charity, right?
At that point, the government can also say, hey, we tried, but the banks. No.
There's basically nothing stopping. In principle, there's nothing stopping them from raising the transaction cost.
They have to listen to what RBI says, isn't it? They came up with demonetization, they have to listen, isn't it?
Ideally.
Because RBI control the currency.
Yeah, they control the currency, but they are sitting on the board of it.
No. Can I, please? Okay. Ideally, the RBI, central bank, cannot and should not and will not control charges by banks, even if it is nationalized bank. So, for example, interest rates are completely and wholly decided by banks, which means that if interest rate is that way, I don't see why transaction costs, all other transaction costs, by the way, if SBI has a card, it is, they decide how much transaction costs to pay. RBI does not have it. So, I don't see why UPI, suddenly RBI can come in and say you can't charge any transaction costs.
So, okay, apart from the endorsement by the government of the private entities, if a bunch of companies come together, come up with a platform that they want to make exclusive within themselves, I don't really see how that is a problem. They don't want to, it is a monopoly, it's an oligopoly, whatever you call it. If Paytm and Recharge, they're buying, one is buying the other out. But if Paytm comes and says to Ola Money that we'll have a private API for transferring money between ourselves.
Firstly, there are competition laws that
Ola
define
money
that.
Allows,
there are competition
laws. Okay.
No, there are.
But okay, today Ola Money will be used, I think, in one of the food payment portals also.
Okay.
Right, and they made an agreement among themselves. I don't see why everybody outside should say Ola Money needs to make everybody accessible to the API. Then they don't want to do that.
No, that's absolutely
so apart
fine,
from the government endorsing Bhima, which is wrong, but as long as it does not add to the equity of the private entity, I don't even think that is too wrong.
What
I
the
understand
government?
The technicality of a prime minister and endorsing
private
company and all of that. All that is correct.
But the government
but
has
the
given
product is not being sold. Yes,
so
it is not making money. Then it's fine. But it might make money and so
okay,
it is
okay,
not, not
so
sold.
If there
when
is
it starts making money, right?
Yeah, correct.
It becomes a market slicing where even if they're going to charge you like 0.1% per transaction, and if everyone moves to digital, then if you have a $1 trillion economy, they're going to get 0.1% of the $1 trillion economy to themselves.
Correct.
That's like $1 billion going to them straight out for doing nothing.
No, I agree.
No.
So
okay, I'll tell you what the problem is. I have understood your question.
But I'm saying if we leave that aside.
No, I've understood your question.
No.
Okay, so if these guys had come up and they'd done this payment systems among themselves and actually had it as monopoly, yes. It's not too big of a problem as you say. But the only thing is, are you allowed to build something else like that? If the answer is yes, then fine, let someone else come up and build competition.
If you're
like,
bank, you can get into association with other banks and do that.
No, that's the point, but you can't build another critical payment infrastructure. You're
no.
not allowed to buy.
See, the definition of critical is
you don't get,
not you have that kind of traction.
You don't
this
get,
goes back to this point.
You don't
if
get
you're like, if
you don't
like
get
Airtel money. And you're popular enough, you come up with
yeah,
any
no,
money
no,
that you
think it's
not
a such a big entry.
You have
to
privately
or
privately
running.
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
Not.
There's
something
yeah.
called network effect.
No,
see,
we all know that.
No, no, so when Jio comes into market, they are able to survive because they are able to connect to all the other networks. Okay, now if the banks are going to say, okay, you start your own payment network, but we won't connect to you.
Yes, we want to go specifically as a differently. That's why even call drops can be regulated by government, right? Otherwise, why would the government get into the business of paying, asking companies to pay back for call drops?
Yes.
So those analogies don't perfectly work. My point is, private companies coming together and building
whatever
they want. What is the
problem?
If
Airtel
money,
you're not
traction.
What the hell? You're not allowed to. Firstly, you're not allowed to. Listen, okay, so now let me explain, right? Firstly, the number of banks in India are extremely limited, as we saw. And if all these banks are together in one this thing, let's say a new bank comes in, it can't enter into this private club, okay, because of the way that the bankers association and the this thing is built. Now, let's say there's
yes,
another
so
one, let me
please
allow me. Secondly, if let's say there's another payment system which does come up, again, that is not being allowed by the RBI. For example, as he rightly pointed out, SWIFT, which is an international thing for payments, wanted to enter India and make it enter into the payment system, but it was not allowed. So you have problems of what is allowed and what is not. If ideally everything is allowed and you have one big player which has emerged because of something, that is still all right. Secondly, there are competition laws which any sort of such association, if you form it, this is nothing but a cartel. Let's never forget that.
Yeah.
It is a problem because it's a cartel, and cartel, according to any sort of competition laws, are dead wrong. I mean,
yeah.
it wouldn't be, if this was in any other industry, right, which was not government kind of blessed, the Competition Commission would have come down on them with a ton of bricks. This
yes.
is what happened to the cement
if
cartel.
If there is any bank that they are disallowing, this is completely wrong.
They are
if
disallowing.
If they specifically tell a bank that you cannot be part of the
yes,
business platform,
they are.
And this is a registered
yes.
bank by the RBI, then it's completely wrong.
They are. That's my point. That if there is a new
yes.
bank that comes
yes.
up, you can't enter into that NPCI without
It's wrong only on the CCI part, but it is wrong.
So it is a competition. No, in that, if you look at how this thing is built, unless you become part of that
cooperative banks have different licenses. That they disallow.
Why not cooperative banks?
Cooperative banks won't go through the same regulatory and audit processes.
If they have to serve a purpose. You have certain amount of deposits. They do have to maintain prudential norms. If that is the case, I don't see why anything else should
happen. I think what would be an ideal case? Right now, government has built something using a specific, built something as a private body, and then still using the control somehow indirectly through the cartels and all of that. A, what is the rationale through building? Instead of doing this, government could have said NPC as a government body and B is a government sponsored app and B is exploded. Would that have been ideal?
No.
If that was not ideal, what would be the ideal?
So according to me, the idea,
all the APIs are open and then government created one app and then said you can also go ahead and create any app. Would that be an ideal scenario?
For me, the second scenario is far more ideal than the first. So according to me, the ideal scenario is if NPCI is meant to be a national in that sense payment corporation, then the API should be to be open to anyone who want. You can put in certain regulations that I can understand anything in terms of prudence, right? That you should just basically protect the consumers against, let's say, a thing that tries to build an app and takes money from one person but does not cost at all.
Yeah.
But these are regulatory hurdles, and which can very easily be taken care of. You don't need any sort of this kind of entry restrictions there. So
that is the most ideal. But if it were not the ideal one, given we know the culture of a government, where they try to make everything monopoly. They make the power distribution monopoly, water distribution monopoly. They want to make the banks monopoly as well. And given the culture, if it were a government entity and then still made exclusive only to government, would it be slightly less than ideal, but would it be entirely than the current system?
No, I don't think so.
It would be better than current one.
I really don't think so. If it was purely government monopoly, you might not have.
It's like,
can I continue to that question?
Yeah.
There's one example where this is actually happening in the IT industry. So when you're talking about all the e-governance projects, right? So they've set up this institution called Center for Good Governance in India, which is like a monopoly to supply all the tech projects, tech related stuff to government entities. Only for government. I don't think they're doing any private because nobody buys from them. But there exists such a case where what he's referring to, I don't know how legal it is, but they have this not written rule that any government IT project will come to CGG. And Infosys or TCS will be considered only as a secondary tertiary client to get it done.
So is that ideal? No, I would say
it's less than ideal, but would it be better than current scenario? Even a different question. You can answer both things.
Okay.
Even a better, even another different question is that what is the rationale in building a structure such a way that is a private entity but still kind of government influence? And everything won't work better. Is it that when the government changes, also these people continue to wield the control of the whole thing?
Allows them to escape hiring and tendering norms. They basically don't have to follow.
Okay, government needs to follow certain things.
Yeah,
they don't need to. They want to bypass that and then still control.
Okay, so the answer to this is
government employees and government employees.
Sorry?
Yeah.
The government sincerely believes, but this is the only way for the government to work.
Technical advisory group for unique projects. So for about 5 projects, UIDA was the first one that was implemented. There are 5 other projects where the government is not going to control them, even though it is basically.
So they want to bypass the normal government processes.
Yeah.
That's why
they
are private.
They speak very frankly about this in public forums.
So the kind of sweet spot that they have found themselves in, right?
Would this also mean, the follow-up question, would this also mean when the government changes, these same people who are a part of this start to continue?
No, because the idea was voted in 2009, I guess.
They, The government doesn't control it anymore. Like GSTN is not in government control. The GST has not even come into
that. I think even more than we can't do anything, then we continue to use the control would be a far more motivating factor for them to put in such a
situation. For the equity holders of the obligation.
So, the kind of sweet spot that presently the NPCI finds itself in is that it has no government oversight or the rules and thing that and accountability that traditionally it has to follow if it was a pure government thing. Yet it enjoys the kind of blessing and this thing by the government, and many people do consider it as a government organization, government this thing, national, and that trust is there. Because I think, I don't know for what reason, but a lot
of
people
of both
still,
worlds,
they are in the best of both worlds. They are in that sweet spot. So the first question, okay.
Yeah, the first question about the government, sorry, that first question, this is the thing that you now spoke about.
Okay.
If the government were to be held to a certain standard for all its projects, and in this case, for they bypassed this to be a government organization because they wanted to avoid the bureaucracy of the governments. Who is going to ensure this bureaucracy? As in, it's the government that is going to enforce that they need to follow certain policies, and the government themselves can allow them not to follow.
You can't have selective rule following, right? There are rules for all such projects. There are overarching rules as to how things should be done, and there's got to be all of those. And you have to open yourself to certain reports or auditing and independent, this thing, all of those things. Now, you know, RTI, for example, now, I don't think you have to be under any of those things.
It's like this is an initial question, just when you brought the cocktail thing.
Okay.
It's slightly out of time to see this conspiracy theory myself.
Sure.
But I'm reading from an IMF report, which refers to this the Honorable Arun Jaitley, Governor of the Fund and the Bank for India. And
Governor
of the Fund.
Okay.
Of the IMF.
Mm-hmm.
And the Bank for India, for India. So he's the governor representing the IMF and the World Bank for India and the constituency of Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, and Sri Lanka.
I didn't know that.
So this seems interesting. Just because he used the word cartel, and so it kind of hit that sentiment. So that's interesting.
Okay.
I see a person with a visa shirt. Are you from visa? Okay, so I'm not
representing visa.
I guess it's not international transactions is part for every MasterCard visa, right? I mean, that's also one of the cards, an example of one of the biggest
So NPCI has RuPay, which ties up with.
In India, RuPay has drastically
lowered
the transaction cost for this thing. So, RuPay's transaction fee is, I think, half of MasterCard or Visa. I'm not really sure, but it is significantly lesser. The only reason being for MasterCard and Visa, the switch is outside India. So, just that it has to be routed through there makes it more costly, whereas RuPay, the switch is domestic.
So, what would it take to create something like MasterCard? I mean, something like which is totally monopolized, right? The regulations and this one required to.
So, MasterCard, for example, by itself, you should understand that it is a not for profit organization and it is built by a consortium of banks.
Okay.
It is not a company.
So,
I mean, it's not a traditional thing.
Once again, we have an announcement. Hi, everyone. If anyone of you is interested in the crypto party, we are downstairs in the ground floor. What's a crypto party? It's just a meet of people where we discuss about secure communication or like cryptography in general. But it's for anyone who is technical and non-technical. If you want to learn about how do you want to securely communicate, or if you want to learn about whatever is needed for your work, you can come join us.
Are you going to be doing key signing also?
Yes. So can I just quickly know the interest level so we can decide on staying or leaving? Okay. Good. Okay, we stay. We'll be downstairs.
So I want to continue this conversation for the last question. Just for a moment, trying to empathize with the government, if we were to be in their position, because in order to get things done through bureaucracy would be really hard. Making this a private player was nevertheless essential for them to do. And if having made this private, there are certain things, so that is not something they were complaining about. Right? I mean, they needed to do NCPI and B, but all it is just private place anyway. Because they could not even have the this, even with that notification under the existing.
No, they could. There's nothing to say that they cannot.
I mean, the bureaucracy would be too hard to get that.
So it's very much based on the building part.